So it's live now, and Kriti, you can put a record on. Yeah, thank you. Ma'am, with your permission, everybody, Dr. Satyajit, Dr. Jairam. Okay, Kriti.
Yes, ma'am. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's live design webinar entitled Design Concepts, Value Engineering, Design Thinking, and Activity-Based Costing, organized by the Department of Clothing and Textiles, Faculty of Family and Community Sciences, in collaboration with the Department of Textile Engineering, Faculty of Technology and Engineering, and Maharaja Ranjit Singh Gaikwad Institute of Design, Faculty of Finance, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda. Most companies approach implementation from checklist of what we need to get done. Instead, think of what the customer expects to accomplish during implementation, a famous quote by Wayne Brock. On the behalf of Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, I, Ms. Kriti Sharma, would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you. We really appreciate you all for taking out your valuable time from your busy schedule and also in such a critical pandemic time. Thus, we cannot stop our learning. The positive approach and energy is must to fight with this tough situation. We know you will learn a lot and expect maximum knowledge from today's webinar. I would first of all take the opportunity to introduce my team, which includes Dr. Reena Bhatia as webinar convener, myself, Ms. Kriti Sharma, Ms. Kanika Chaudhary, and Ms. Sumi Haldar. Before starting the program, let's rise together for a university song.
तेरे को तो साइंड नहीं आ रहा
क्या
ऑडियो
ही फोन दे रहा
ऑडियो नहीं आ रहा
देयर इज एन इशू इन ऑडियो
Starting the program, there are few instructions which need to be followed. If you have questions during the presentation, please type them into the chat box with your name, designation, and affiliation. We will surely bring them during the presentation, and we will also have time for your question answers after each consecutive talk. Please mute your mic for the entire session. The feedback link will be shared at the end of the session. We will have a question and answer round after each given design concept. There are three design concepts in hands, three question and answer rounds we will have. Looking forward to your active engagement. Without much delay, now, I firstly would like to thank our patron, Professor Parimal Vyas, Honorable Vice Chancellor of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, to have always supported us in our academic and extracurricular endeavors, especially the one today with equal conviction. Now, I would invite our webinar director, Dr. Jayaram Podugal, Associate Director, Maharaja Ranjit Singh Gaikwad Institute of Design, Faculty of Fine Arts, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, to render the welcome address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Kriti. Hello, everyone. Before we start the welcome address, I'd like to congratulate one of our director, Professor Satish Chowdhury, who has been appointed as a Vice Dean of Technology Faculty. Congratulations, Satya. So hello, everyone. On behalf of Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda and its integral units, Department of Clothing and Textile, Department of Textile Engineering, and Maharaja Ranjit Singh Gaikwad Institute of Design, I, Dr. Jayaram Podugal, webinar director, welcome you all to this live design webinar. It is with the blessing of Professor Parimal Vyas, Honorable Vice Chancellor of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, and his constant encouragement to focus on multidisciplinary approaches and a holistic education for our students that we have come together to organize this special webinar entitled Design Concepts, Value Engineering, Design Thinking, and Activity-Based Costing, which is truly multidisciplinary since it touches across the science, arts, and social sciences, and of course, design. To ensure the topic unites and integrates all knowledge, we have invited a highly experienced and versatile technologist whom we warmly welcome, our valued speaker, respected Mr. Ashok Sarda, founder of Future Fab, integrating style with technology from our own city, Vadodara. Welcome, sir. Welcome to Professor Sarda.
Thank you.
With great pleasure, I welcome our special guest, Professor Anjali Karolia, Dean Faculty of Family and Community Science, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, whose direction we always seek. Welcome, ma'am, but I think ma'am is slightly busy with some dean's meeting, but still, we'll welcome her. Last but not least, I heartily welcome all the curious, intelligent, and enthusiastic participants, which includes students from right from first year BBA graduation to PhD students, the teachers and professionals on the field of fashion, clothing, textile engineering, and design, who have joined us from different parts of the country in large numbers, both in Zoom room and on Facebook Live. Welcome, one and all, to this multidisciplinary design webinar with the conviction that it would be fruitful for everyone present here. Thank you and welcome again. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Due to some urgent meeting, our special guest of today's webinar, the Dean of the Faculty of Family and Community Sciences, Professor Anjali Karolia, is not able to join for now. But whenever she will be joining, she will be surely having some special remarks from her side. So now, I would like to invite our webinar director and also the head of the Department of Clothing and Textiles, Faculty of Family and Community Sciences, Professor Madhu Sharan, to orient us about today's webinar. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Kriti. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good afternoon, each and everyone present here. And first of all, with due respect, I thank our Vice Chancellor, Professor Parimal Vyas, for permitting us to organize this webinar. I thank our Dean, Professor Anjali Karolia, for motivating, encouraging us to keep doing our duties, whatsoever comes in the way. The result is the webinar, wherein the three departments of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda have come together for deliberations on design concepts, value engineering, design thinking, and activity-based costing. Welcome, Dr. Jayaram Podugal and Dr. Satyajit Chowdhury, sir, to this webinar. And Congratulations to the webinar convener, Dr. Reena Bhatia, and her team members, Ms. Kriti Sharma, Ms. Kanika Chaudhary, and Ms. Sumi Haldar, for their efforts in organizing this event. And I welcome Mr. Ashok Sarda, who is the invited speaker for the day, and welcome all the audience who have joined this webinar from different platforms. Our history has always given us a lesson. Adapt the changes in the environment, one. Second, change is the key for the survival and development. These have been proven true over the centuries, and we should now introspect ourselves whether we are following that or not. Development is more successful in collaboration than in isolation. This, the 21st century, empowers us in our respective fields with lots of scope, challenges, competitions, and innovations worldwide. We have resources, technologies, artificial intelligence, and endless ideas to incorporate and make everything possible. Textile is one of the sectors in which there is a lot of fluctuations because it has to cater to human needs. As the fashion changes, the product changes, and comes change in the design, form, color, texture, and many more other aspects. Though we have many reputed textile industries in our country, need is felt for developing successful product. By successful product, we not only mean its look and appearance, but also other peripheral factors which designing and manufacturing background people, including students and teachers, need to understand. Today's webinar lays an emphasis on conceptual understanding of design. Through the deliberation here, it is our earnest endeavor to enhance and encourage logical decision-making and innovation in design fraternity. It is also an opportunity to update one's knowledge of newer design concepts to improve employability and enterprise too. As nowadays, companies are hiring the consultants to give the solution to the problems and developing the system methods for manufacturing of products. Today's webinar will focus on design concepts, which highlights the importance of value engineering, design thinking, and activity-based costing that will help us all to design effective solutions for the challenges of product development as per the market needs. It will guide us how to create value for our products, follow logical thinking, and how to gain from the new cost system. Not just make an enterprise successful, but the entire sector victorious. We are glad that we have Mr. Ashok Sarda, our expert with valuable experience in these areas, and thus look forward to hear and collect the priceless knowledge shared by him in this webinar. Welcome you, Mr. Ashok Sarda. Sir, today in the audience, we have staff and students from diverse background. They are from Department of Clothing and Textile, Fashion Technology, Textile Engineering, Institute of Designing. And I think everybody is waiting for your deliberations. And not to keep them waiting, I hand over to Ms. Kriti Sharma for further proceedings.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, madam. Now, I would like to invite our webinar director and also the head department of textile engineering. He is also been appointed as the vice dean of the Faculty of Technology and Engineering, Dr. Satyadeep Tolpi, to introduce our speaker of the webinar. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Kriti. I'm very happy to introduce Mr. Ashok Sarda. He's a very rich and dynamic, having very dynamic experience in the field of textile chemicals. He has done B.Tech in chemical engineering from Nagpur University. He's a cellulose technologist with a postgraduate diploma in international trade from IIFT, that is Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, Delhi. He worked about 10 years in water, energy, and environment management with leading American companies and having 20 years of experience in textile field that ranges from sizing to finishing with specialization in printing. He has worked with both global and local retailers for apparel and home furnishings, and also with their vendors. He has international experience from working in textile hubs of Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, and Africa. Initially, he worked as a district manager and area manager in Nalco Chemicals, Dahej, Gujarat, from 1989 to 1996. He was looking after sales and strategy on all India basis. He developed 4P strategy based on marketing insights, implement and achieve target growth in sales. Since 2001, he worked as a vice president in Zydex Industry, Vadodara, Gujarat, where he grew sales 25 times in terms of volume and 40 times in terms of profitability for the last 10 years. He has been an all-rounder entrepreneur, employee, consultant, with multiple industries and having an assignment experience, which includes turnarounds, profitability improvement, and growth, business growth. He has good eye to analyze complex situations quickly and come out with very simple and easy implement solution, giving a quantum jump in value creation. He is a versatile technologist in the field of substitution, replacement, energy consumption, machine utilization, hardware audit. He has good knowledge regarding value addition by screen printing. He has published many articles in the field of energy cost reduction in textile processing. Name some of the other articles that is missing on the occasion of International Women's Day: lifestyle to textile, textile industry, value addition through screen printing. Then 4 tips to cope with the current scenarios in the textile business. And presently his another meaningful endeavor is on the YouTube series that is Lifestyle to Textile. He is a founder of Future Fab, creating styles with technology in Vadodara. The services being offered are supply of RFP, that is ready for print fabrics, that is RFP fabrics under the brand name of Future Fab, providing technical support and solutions for designing to manufacturing to marketing, and provide support to reduce cost and pollution through the value engineering and sustainable processing. Apart from the textile experience, he runs educational trust with the name Sharda Education Trust in rural area at Amravati, Maharashtra. He was instrumental in getting NAC accreditation for the college. Trained and motivated teaching and non-teaching faculty in innovation to improve the institution and education quality. Ashok Sharda has a rich experience, expertise, and deep understanding of market. His knowledge will be invaluable for us. This is what a brief about him. Now, I'm very much thankful to the speaker. Thank you, sir. And welcome to you.
Thank you.
And I hand over to the Krati. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parimal Vyas, Dr. Podwal, Dr. Professor Madhu Saran, Dr. Reena Bhatia, Dr. Anjali Kacholia, Dr. Satyajit, Dr. Mr. Deepak Vishwakarma, Krithi Sharma, and all her friends. Basically, I will not try to give some theory of value engineering because there are a lot of books on that subject. My purpose of introducing value engineering is on practical application in textile industry and fashion industry. First of all, fashion industry has three problems. One is value loss, which is the biggest loss to the fashion industry, where the retailers are not able to sell the goods. So that's again value engineering, which can help to solve that loss, because traditionally retailers make hardly 5 to 7% margins today, but the value loss runs into 30-35%. So why does it happen? Because there are multiple reasons. The price value equation of the product is not right. The time at which the goods reach the market is not right. And third thing is the basic analysis of the consumer needs is not right. So
we as Indians, being a sort of a low per capita income country, always are value conscious. We don't have surplus incomes, so all our consumers are looking for value for money. That's the real word, VFM. So value comes every day. It's value addition, value engineering, value loss, value for money. Wherever you see, there is value. Now, how does this science help us? This science was actually evolved from steel industry, engineering industry. This came in 1960. There was some Society for American Value Engineers. TISCO was a pioneer to promote this concept in India. They started an Indian Society for Value Engineers in Jamshedpur. There was one book written by value engineering by Mr. S.S. Iyer, who was a TISCO employee. I happened to read this book, and I was always reading about value engineering. It is not a, basically, it's a unique discipline of knowledge, more based on common sense. The common sense is what consumer wants in his function of service or the product, and what he pays us for, and what does it cost to deliver that function with innovative ideas. Most of the times, we are stuck in past dogmas. We don't know what the consumer thinking has changed. For example, today, just to tell you, people don't buy clothes for a long duration today. People buy clothes for even, this is called like a disposable fashion. It's like use and throw. So the longevity of the fabric or longevity of the durability of the product is going for a toss. So I have seen always retailers insisting on very tough durability standards. Like there was a brand, Marks and Spencer, they had very tough standard on durability. Now what happened? Their products became very expensive. The durability was not required by the consumer. So the products were not selling in the stores. Suddenly they realized that in the fashion high street, there are 10 retailers on the same road selling similar products at 20-30% cheaper price. And they suddenly dropped their standard to the realistic level that what consumer was buying. And then they called it Plan B. Plan B was like a durability which is required by the consumer. So they don't want to wash it too frequently. The chemicals were not required, very difficult chemicals were not required to apply those durability standards like fastness, wet rub, dry rub. So the cost came down and then they survived. So I jokingly asked the quality head of that global retailer. He said, I told him they were washing at 90 degrees. And I told him, boss, your wife and my wife, they wash clothes in washing machine at just 35-40 degrees. So why do you want to wash it at 90 degrees? And then washing machine, they had some cycle of 45-60 minutes. And I said, in a washing machine, typical cycle is less than 10-15-20 minutes. So why don't you test at the standard at which the average consumer uses our clothes? And for that he had no answer. And see, similar are the biggest blunders which happen in biggest corporations. Like the Marks and Spencer learned that lesson the hard way. Similar lessons may be learned on all big corporations. So value engineering is a subject. I'll just give an example. This is practically used in civil industry. Civil engineering, they want to reduce the weight of the building. Because of that, they want to also reduce the thickness of the wall so the carpet area goes up. And the structural engineer is paid for reducing the weight of the building without affecting the strength of the building. So structural engineers are valued that they can reduce the cost of the building by 10%, but without, and they want to give more area. In automobiles, if you see, the weight of the cars went down. So material went down, but the average of the car went up. So people are valuing not the weight of the car, but the average of the car. Now similarly, if you see in textile, all designers, whether they call themselves as creative people. I'm sorry, because sometimes designers live in their own world. But design in isolation has no meaning. It's what, as you study in the school, it's called life is 33% arts, 33% commerce, 33% science. So value engineering teaches you to integrate all three, arts, commerce and science. So it's a holistic solution which has to work in the market. So coming to textile, now I'll just give an example. how does value engineering can help you? If we have a lot of jute, kenaf, alternative fibers, which are not value added today, and we use them only in packaging, etc., etc. I was wondering, in my house we bought a lot of curtains these days. What I found that in those thick fabrics, we could easily add 40-50% jute and create a fabric which is 30-40% cheaper, and that is easily possible. All the home furnishings, we could add 30-40% jute and reduce the cost. So you have to think right from the fiber usage itself. The designer has to think like that. What are the alternate fibers available? I have seen this jute, kenaf, flax being used more detail in Russia. Now they are not a jute growing country. I don't know what is the reason, but we are a jute growing country. Bangladesh is a jute growing country. So how do you add value? You look at fibers, replace the fibers with a costly fiber with a cheaper fiber. Now you have got recycled fibers, PET, recycled PET fiber, recycled cotton. Now a lot of discarded clothing goes into the landfill. People want to reclaim fiber from that. So value engineering starts from that. It's simple definition of value engineering is function divided by cost. Now function is the what appeals to the consumer, and cost is always the lowest denominator. So people want to buy everything cheap, cheap. That's the way any consumer wants. So we enhance the functionality without affecting the cost. Now for understand the functionality, just to come to an example, we started with fiber, then you start with go to the weaving. Now in weaving also, people try to compromise on the weaving quality, etc. They try to enhance the weight of the fabric, and then they don't wash the fabric properly, then they are not able to print properly or dye properly. So the sizing is not done properly. So in this case, what they try to save, there is a wrong value engineering there. Sometimes people want to save cost in a wrong way. And then just to come to designers, they don't want to pay the designers. Because in India, most of the designs, 98% are copied. So designers are not considered to be adding value. Now it's a dichotomy. We have so many design colleges, but designers are not valued, at least in the lower end of the market, what I'm seeing today in say places like Rajasthan and Jodhpur, etc. The designs are just created by some printing master, some dyeing master. So designers have to create their own value for the market. Designers have to be think like entrepreneurs. So value engineering can help the designers. How they can, I can see designer can reduce the cost of the product by 10 to 15% by using creative ideas, and designer can enhance the value of the product by 10 to 20% in different ideas. Just to give an example, there was a cell in Alkapuri of Chimanlal Vijral. It was about 15, 20 years back. And I walked into the cell. The designer had created a jute partition with simple chuna geru on that and with some old road gate there. And it was looking elegant. And the material was not costing anything. It was designer's creativity, which impressed me. And this is where the designers come in. So designers not only reduce the cost of the product itself. So how much, I'll just tell you the example of designer thinking, sourcing the fabric right. Now in India, what I've seen, the fabric width is say 43 inches. And I was told that when you go to wider width, 75 inches, 78 inches, the marking efficiency goes down, the cutting losses goes down. Now the designer has to insist, there is a loom which weaves at 82 inches and you can get 75 inches fabric out of it. Then if you are buying 43 inches fabric, the loom fellow is running inefficiently, the printing fellow is running inefficiently. But if the designer says, no, I want 75 inches fabric, the loom efficiency will go up, the cost will go down for the weaver, the cost of processing will go down, and marking efficiency will go down. Marking efficiency will go up, sorry. So you are cutting the cost 10% by insisting on a wider width fabric, and reducing wastage also 10%. So you are actually saving 20%, just changing the width. Now imagine there are a lot of people who have huge bedsheet looms, 90 inches, 120 inches. Can we make apparel fabrics on that? 90 inches, 120 inches, and use in apparel industry. Why that bedsheet loom has to be used only for bedsheets? It can't be in apparel. This is value engineering. This is real value engineering. You don't make money sometimes in bedsheet. So right, coming to from fabric. Next comes the processes. Now there is a process like yarn dyeing. Now yarn dyeing is a very complex process. You have to do dye the yarn, then weave it, the strength of the yarn goes down. So if designers create the same effect through printing, the yarn dyeing process can be replaced and same functionality can be given to the consumer. Now there is a funny thing, sometimes the consumer thinks, and the, at least this is a trade perception, that they say consumer wants design on both sides, which I find very easy to difficult to digest. As a consumer, I don't care what is inside the apparel. As a consumer, I want to see only the exterior of the apparel. But they say, nahi, dono baju chahiye. And that I don't understand. So if designers create, see, it's the designers who can change the thought process of the society. Just to example is diesel. Diesel sold torn jeans to the world, and today it's a rage. So do you think 10 years back it was a normal sense to put on a torn jeans? Today people pay premium for a torn jean, and Diesel made a $3 billion sales out of that torn jeans. And they always said, be stupid, don't be smart. This be stupid means think out of the box. Smart people have a rigid box. So their ad campaign was be stupid. And I am proud of being stupid. So value engineering is one subject where designers can change the thought process of the society. See, what have designers create articles which are start with celebrities. Now celebrities are imitated by the common man gradually. So the original ideas come from designer to celebrities, celebrity to the common man. So thought process of the society can be changed by the designers because they are the creative people. And we have to, as designers, our Indian designers have to be in thinking process itself Indian. I have seen most of the time the fashion college students, designers, only thinking on some foreign material, foreign resource, foreign designs, imitation, inspirations. We have to go for Indian raw materials, Indian manufacturing capabilities. Sometimes designers come out with very complex manufacturing capabilities, processes, which our shop floor people are not capable of achieving. Then there is a problem. So the whatever creative design is there, it is not produced in time. Now design has a time value. See, I call fashion is like a perishable commodity today. It's like vegetable. After 9 o'clock, there is no value for vegetable. You have the shopkeeper, it does the distress sale. So if your merchandise, if you do create a complicated design, it's difficult to manufacture on the shop floor, and merchandise doesn't be in the store. And India, invariably I'm seeing 40% only is on time delivery. 160% is not on date. You lose 2 weeks, 3 weeks, the fashion becomes outdated, particularly in women's wear, which is very fast fashion. It may be not less in the home furnishing, it may be less in men's wear. So design has to be producible on the shop floor. So that's again value engineering, but if you get delayed, you lose value. See, I've seen almost this 35% value loss comes because we are late on the shop floor. Fourth is how to create the appeal from value enhancement. Now value addition, I'll just give an example like in dyeing. See, we have regularly traditionally been doing reactive dyeing or dye-based dyeing. We don't do much pigment-based dyeing. Now I have seen this very popular in Pakistan. Now what does it do? It reduces pollution. It gives you some fancy wash-off effects. It also increases the weight of the kapda. So what is happening? While dyeing, you are getting the material weight cost of the fabric. So actually your kapda is 250 rupees, 300 rupees a kilo. And when you dye with pigments, the weight goes up by 5-10%, you save 20 rupees. So actually your dyeing cost half is recovered through pigment dyeing. Now this is not very popular in India, and we have a lot of water issues, a lot of pollution issues. Now designers have to come out that this design, pigment dyeing was very popular for all the sportswear brand abroad. But I have never seen an Indian designer thinking of pigment dyeing on t-shirts, etc., on knits also. So we have a traditional mindset in India. We don't even observe what is going on around the world. And that is to be suited for Indian conditions. India has no water today. We are a water-stressed country. So we can't have water-intensive processes. Now coming to printing, dyeing, we choose very dark colors sometimes. Now what is happening? We are a hot climate country. So we should avoid use of very dark colors, because it's wrong for our climate, number one. Number two, it creates difficulty in achieving fastness standards. It it doesn't allow us to do pigment dyeing or pigment printing, because those dark colors are not achievable with a traditional printing. So as a result, this traditional dye-based dyeing, dye-based printing is very complicated. And our shop floor workers are confused. Just to give an example, in Surat, basically there are multiple fibers in women's wear: polyester, cotton, silk, linen, nylon, this, that. Now each fiber requires different set of dyes, different chemistry. Now that's a nightmare. So what they have done today in Surat, there is one guy doing only polyester, one master doing only cotton, one guy doing only PC, one guy doing rayon. So there are five multiple masters. Now all this can be simplified with value engineering. It's pigment dyeing, pigment printing. Can it, what does it do? It simplifies the processes. It makes the process simple. It can make the process faster, because pigment sits on all the substrates. Now world has not done much research on this subject, but India needs to do research on pigments, because India requires sustainability. Pigment has multiple advantages. Yeah, it had some drawbacks. We, as a company, when I was in Zydex, we worked on those drawbacks for 5 years. And we successfully developed the technology to replace this dye-based printing with pigments in the model of value engineering itself. Because it was sustainable, it was fashionable. So what I call it was SAF fashion: sustainable, aspirational, attitudinal, affordable, fast and fresh. So why? Because pigment allowed us to get digital looks on screen printing. So we could get very high fine pixels, 800 dpi, 1200 dpi on fabrics. We could get fluorescent colors, very bright colors. It was possible. We also developed some knowledge on doing some penetration with pigments, or we could do some hybrid technology, pigment and dyes together, to reduce pollution and create it non-polluting, make it non-polluting. So sustainability was important, designing was important, wastage control was important. So again, we came with an acronym called CRPVW. One was cost reduction, which I am going to discuss later. R was rejection control. So rejection control is very important in any process, because textile industry or fashion industry works on very low margins today. P is process simplification or productivity improvement. If you simplify the process, production goes up. V is value addition or value engineering or value loss control. And W is waste minimization. So that is water waste, energy waste, pollution, etc. So these are all the principles which are embedded in value engineering. Now value engineering is a multidisciplinary subject. It is not a function. All the topics which I am going to discuss today are a multidisciplinary function, where people from finance, marketing, designing, shop floor, even costing, ICWA, they have to come together and think on lines. People sell on what people are buying on the shop floor, what they value, what they don't value. We need to understand that. What are they going to pay for it? Are they going to not pay for a fabric which has a color inside? Why do we dye? To printing. One side coat, job done. I can show you the fabrics where we avoided dyeing with printing. We just coated the fabric. This is non-polluting. It's printed. You can do this. It can be done one side on a thick fabric. It can be done two side on thin fabric. I have done it on polyester, which is non-polluting. It is non-getting the weight of the fabric, and you save money. You save pollution. So you can do penetration. Now coming to designing. Now we have created designs like yarn dyed loop, and we created through printing. So this design was replacement of yarn dyeing. So these are the areas where we worked. Now we used to do printing on rayon, where tinting was a problem. We did printing with pigments, and there was no tinting problem on the white background. Now this was a digital loop which I printed, where we could use the principle of value engineering, because digital is very expensive. In India, people can't afford it. So we thought, why can't we do this with screen printing? The extra cost of better designing, better Photoshop and all that stuff is hardly 2 to 3%. But the fabric value got enhanced by almost 30-40%. Even the consumer pass on a discount of 20% to the consumer, the material flies off the shelf. So we thought digital look. Then bright colors. This was a bright color we could create through pigment printing. Now this was some example of value engineering, where we didn't do dyeing and we didn't do discharge. We just printed and kept the fabric white, and this is again a value engineering principle, where the effect of dyeing printing was done through printing alone. So there was no dyeing, the process was fast, the white fabric was a contrast. Like what you see today, we have a scheme called polka dots in women wear. Now women's wear polka dot, can you create keeping that white, etc. like that and print the blotch, so no dyeing and then no reprinting on that. So this is the name of the game, where you think out of the box, think on multiple fibers. I went to recently to Pondicherry, and there I saw a studio where all the foreigners are staying there in Aruvile, and they said now the next game is not recycling, upcycling. Now today we are facing pandemic. People will not have money to buy clothing, people will have distress. So how do you create merchandise which is affordable in this scenario? So they were talking of upcycling. So there are a lot of clothes which are discarded and not worn by one, two times, three times. Now H&M has started collecting old clothes, refurbishing them and reselling them. So I was reading about upcycling. You can see on the net. So a lot of people now will come with an upcycling model, whether it is menswear, home furnishing. You buy the old cloth, upgrade it, use it in some other way, and sell it as a new merchandise, which could be sold in a different market. So these are all the principles of value engineering, value addition. So people even take say cutting waste from the basically shop floor, and the cutting waste they are making apparels out of it, some bags out of it. So these are the ideas of all value addition, value enhancement, value engineering. And what it does, you think like a chemical engineer, you think like a material, what is the material science, how much material I am consuming, how much cotton is going to that, how much the consumer is going to pay me for that cotton, and how fast I can deliver to him. Yeah, you have to be creative in pattern making and print designing and all that. That is what is designer's job is. But the other ideas which you need to pick up, like I am not a design person, but I can see, okay, what you people do as designers from a third perspective. Like you have maybe the abstract design, floral design, animal design, and those seven designs route keep on going in rounds and rounds. So that's what I feel as a designer, what you do. And then you have pattern making, and I see as an outsider. Similarly, you have to see the process outside your area, the lateral knowledge. Also, costing, all those things, what the shop floor people are doing, how they are making the fabric, textile processing. Today, textile engineering is there. I wish textile chemistry department was there. Even the ICWA, there is a local chapter in Baroda, Institute of Cost and Works Accountancy, and local management college, your management department. Even they were part of this seminar, because commerce department, arts department, everybody has to be thinking together as a team. No project can be solved by a single channel of knowledge. There is always a multidisciplinary knowledge. Even suppose a cotton is there and how cotton is grown, the agriculture guys are there, important. So the petrochemical fibers are coming. So the petrochemical people are involved in the processing of petrochemical fibers, synthetic fibers. So we have to think out of the box on these areas. And value engineering is one science which helps us to look at alternatives, alternative options. Think imaginatively. It's all about creativity. So value engineering is a thought process. Read about it. There are so many videos on the YouTube about it. There's a professor, Dr. Inder Singh, who is from IIT Roorkee. He has a lecture of a series of 20 lectures. So to summarize his lectures in 30 minutes is not easy. But I am trying to give you the overview of the subject and how we can apply it in the industry. So with that, I am coming to my end of the first session, and about anything else I want to, you can always write to me and also see on the net. I learned most of the subject on YouTube, and basically that was my teacher. I bought them books. So there is a huge body of knowledge which keeps evolving. Value engineering will keep changing, and we have to apply it in every discipline. It is not only in textile designing. It can be in automobile design, it can be in furniture design, because there are Professor Dr. Kodwal is there from Institute of Design. So like today, bamboo furniture. Now bamboo furniture can be like furniture design. So we have to think like that. Even designing, I have seen wallpaper design going to textile, jewelry design can go to textile or vice versa. So designs can be cross transplanted, so design cost can be reduced. And one more thing, what I feel as designers you should be taking is the entrepreneurial route. We have Anita Dongre, one of the designers, becoming an entrepreneur. Now people, Tommy Hilfiger, people talk of Tommy Hilfiger. Now similarly, designers have to be responsible for the sales multi created by their designs. Unless they think like that, nobody is going to pay you as designer, as an entrepreneur. But if you can get that, and one more idea which I always feel, that India has got a huge population of handlooms, and those designs, those people needs a lot of design intervention for value engineering, and we can add a lot of value through our production process. Then value can be created through branding process, value can be created through retailing process. So value engineering is a science which can go up to right up to end consumer. How do you retail, how do you produce, how do you brand? So all that, those ideas we need to add together. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a very fruitful session on the practical application of value engineering, right from fiber like jute, kenaf, recycled fiber, weaving quality, yarn dyeing, scopes of pigment in the model of value engineering. So we move on to the Q&A session. So the first question is from Saminathan Ratnapadan. The question is, what about the materials from agro waste?
Yeah, that's a good question. From agro waste, I can say that there is only one fiber which I have so far understood was banana fiber. So banana fiber is getting traction. Other agro waste, we have not studied much, but banana fiber is one looks promising. Balance, we cannot produce fibers out of it. That's the main problem. Otherwise, you can make some, tomorrow some technology comes where non-wovens could be produced out of it. That could be one idea for agro waste. For weaving part, fiber length is important. That's my understanding. So banana could be one promising fiber from the agro waste. Banana fiber looks promising. And recycled fibers are looking promising.
Sir, the next question is, what about sisal fiber?
What one?
What about sisal fiber? Sisal fiber.
I have no idea about it. But see, any fiber which can be woven has to have some other properties as well. See, just to give an example, like jute is very harsh. So make it soft, you have to remove the lignin out of jute. Now, if that fiber is not usable for apparel, then you can think of other ideas. As I said, you can use for home furnishing. The characteristic of the fiber is important. So if you can use for home furnishing, non-wovens, or people talked, you know, the road construction, etc. So application of the fiber has to be done in the principle of value engineering only. So if the fiber is hard, you use in a place where the hardness is important. The place is soft, fiber is soft, use it where the softness gives you premium. So how is the fiber is important. Then it's a multiplicity approach. Think with the designers, have to sit with the agriculture people, the production guys, the cost economics, and then work out a product and see what is learning in the market with the where harshness is not a problem, but softness is important. So then you can evaluate any fiber.
Sir, the third question is, what's the relationship between ergonomics and value engineering in developing a commercial product?
Yeah, see, economics is again, as I told you, function versus cost. Function is nothing but what consumer values for. And how can you give it at the lowest possible cost? So functionality, economics is a part of cost only. Now, it's a very simple example. When you see end of season sales in the stores, what do you see? Same article, people wait, they will buy during the sale. So they wait that 35% discount jab aata hai, people go to buy. It's all economics. So people the retailer is not very happy to give discount. But economics is important because if you produce at the wrong cost, the consumers are going to pay you. And you have to think what consumer and who is consumer. First of all, let's understand who is the consumer. Consumer is, I'll tell you, in the instead of clothing, from jewelry, 90%, 95%, 98% consumer are housewives. So they are very smart consumers, very price sensitive consumer. Their market intelligence is very smart, very good. So you ask your housewife, your mother, your sister, what she is going to pay for you, whether the article is good enough for that money what you created. If the answer is no, that's the voice of the consumer, VOC. So you have to think what consumer is looking for. That will the economics comes in. If your article is expensive for their eyes, then you are wrong, doing something wrong.
Thank you so much, sir. So due to the limitations of time, all the questions cannot be taken, but I'm putting the mail address of our speaker, of the webinar speaker, Mr. Ashok Sharda, so you can put your questions and queries. Thank you, sir. We move on to our second session, that is design thinking. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. Design thinking, again, is nothing but a science which was recently started by Stanford University. Stanford University thought that design thinking can solve life's lot of problems. So they had a five-step process. Now, design thinking, first process was empathize or think like a consumer. So you go to the, as I told you just now, that you talk to basically ladies or people. I saw sometimes a lot of people go abroad to buy something. I said, why do you buy abroad? They say, no, India, we don't get good quality. Or sometimes I found a lot of relatives of mine coming from outside and I took them to Indian stores. Then I said, ki kaisa lagta hai kapda? He said, no, you are not good, you are going to be to Bangladesh also. Your clothing, American clothing is mostly coming from Bangladesh and your clothing is not good enough. I said, what do you like? He said, print nahi acha lagta hai. So now understanding that is empathizing with the customer. And then the perceived value of the product is X. And the consumer doesn't perceive it like a 0.8X. It's a biological process. Value is biological process, no logic. If you give a pen to 10 people, this pen, 10 people will say 10 different price for this pen. Somebody will say 15 rupees, somebody will say 20 rupees, somebody will say 10 rupees, somebody will say 18 rupees. Now, if your MRP is above the perceived value of the median, then below the perceived value, then you are able to sell to the people who are above that perceived value. And if it is higher than their perceived value, you are not able to sell. So empathize means you talk to the consumer. What is looking for, what is not looking for. As I told you, like some features he is not looking for. And aap usko kyun dete ho? Piche kapde mein color chahiye, nahi chahiye. So why you give him? So I asked him every time. In fact, the color at the back is allergic to the skin of the consumer. So why do you want to give him the color at the back of the skin, touching his skin? So this is what the empathy. Now, once you empathize with the customer, you hear him out, you go to the store, you talk to your surrounding. Whenever I used to do some printing trial, I used to show to 5-10 ladies, उनको पूछता था कि कैसे लग रहा है, hand feel कैसे लग रहा है, brightness कैसे लग रही है, आपको design में मजा आ रहा है. They used to say, no. So then I used to again rework, कि I am going somewhere wrong. So design thinking is like empathizing the first, the consumer. Then they'll tell you what are the problems. The next question is problem solve. They will say, हमको तो अच्छा print नहीं मिल रहा है. I'll tell you example, digital printing. India, you hardly see any digital printing on clothing done through screen printing. Whether it is our bed sheet, whether it is our simple barber's cloth or anything, there is no digital printing. Done digital quality printing. Digital quality is a wrong name. It's a raster and vector printing. Now, when you create raster image, it's a halftone graded effect image. So, can you print through screens? It is possible? Yes, it is possible. How complicated it is? Nothing. So, people say, humko digital look ka gulab ka phool chahiye. Gulab ka phool, can you print? Yeah. But not that handmade gulab ka phool. Now, how much you will pay extra? They'll say, hum uska 20% extra denge. So, empathize with the customer. What are they looking for? Problem solve. Then, once they tell you, then is the ideation. Then you come to the idea. Aapko photo print nahi aata hai. Let's say, created a single multi white, black and white design. Ek hi color ka. Print with nice 600, 800 dpi, nice pixel, etc. Print one color. Aapko aa gaya. I have printed four color design on hand tables. Now, I tell you, we have a lot of small runs. People want small MOQs. Like lot of boutiques are there. They want small runs. Now, can you create small MOQs? in the lowest possible cost. They pay you premium, but they pay you maybe 1x to 2x. But can you create a design and it is in a smaller lot and economical price? They'll pay. You'll make money. The consumer will make money. They want a unique design. So ideate, then come the problem solve. You can't have a machine-based printing for small MOQs. So forget about machines. Can you create on a small table, print like that, very quality design? So ideate, then comes to problem solve. Okay, my consumer is looking for this. Now, for example, I'll tell you sometimes, today India, COVID is there. So people want, you know, virus protection. Now, can you save some money and give some virus protection in that kapda? So problem solve. So they will feel safe. So design, empathize, identify the problem, then ideate, create ideas. Ki humko kya kya karna hai. Again, it's a multidisciplinary approach. You have to have a cost accountant, you have to have maybe a finance guy, a marketing guy. Marketing guy is actually bringing the voice of the consumer. Hamare yahan kya hota hai ki whenever marketing guy comes with the idea or designer comes with the idea, the production guys kill him. Aisa ho hi nahi sakta. Or they, in the Bengali we call it hobena, Gujarati they call it nathai. So whenever there is a new idea, the production people are the first to kill it. I wish our production guys, the design guys, the sales guys, go to, there are seminars like India Retail Forum. So they hear the voice of the consumer and everybody has to hear. Only one guy hearing the voice of consumer is not important. So then ideation will be on the right track, because ideation cannot happen with one person's thinking. It's a multi-phase approach. So when you go to the exhibitions, five people from five different fields have to go together. Designers, cost accountant, textile chemistry, textile engineering, all these people, management guys. Now today textile engineering is there, textile chemistry, fashion people, design people, then costing people, management people or marketing people, they have to come together. And then understand what, then come to this, humko 400 rupees mein shirt bana ke bechna hai. Like Tata Nano had a target to pay, like, produce a car at 1 lakh rupees and they work backwards. So we say, okay, this 400 rupees dress will sell. And how much it will sell? You have to guess. Ki chalo. Then for that, that guess is a major problem in India. That fashion industry is actually becoming a gambling industry. It's like making a movie. Picture, you don't know, you make spend 100 crores. See, before movie launch, you have teasers, you have trailer to get the consumers on board. But you can't book a order for a movie in advance. Ki chalo, aap hamari ticket kharidenge. But in textile, it is possible. So after ideation, prototyping, the prototyping is the next step. Aapko us, jaise car mein hota hai, car mein automobile industry has a prototype. So there, here also in textile, we have to create a garment. So we can make a small fabric, small pattern, make a design and send it for sampling. That's prototyping. A prototype mein kya hoga? Aapko pata chal jayega ki at that price, whether the consumer is going to buy or not. That is the fifth step. Once you make a prototype, you go for testing. Now, what is the cost of prototyping? That's not much. It's about 2 to 3% of the cost of the end article lot. Suppose I'm producing 2000 pieces of design. What design, what size? Well, suppose you are making garment. Then you know which design, which size people are getting in the orders. Then for fabric designing, in fabric design, there's an order. You say, there are matching, what they call is 4 or 5 color combos. Now, which color in India, what I've seen always, people don't do prototyping and then they suffer a huge loss. So prototyping and then last step is testing. Testing the concept in the market. Go to the concept. I went to a shop here, Sejal Handicraft. They have a factory. Wahi store hai, wahi factory hai. What happens? The consumer comes there. They test the concept. Consumer bolta hai, maza nahi aaya. They change the design immediately. They redo the design and they again put to the store. So the value loss, the prototyping, testing happens close by. But in a long chain, kapda kahi banta hai, bikta kahi aur hai. So there is a problem of communication and then you lead to value loss. So design thinking is prototyping. Like I have seen, the sari is produced in Jaipur, sold in Kolkata. Most of the sarees produced in Jaipur are sold in Kolkata. Now they have to do prototyping or they go to Bihar, Odisha. Or so the fabric produced in Gujarat and sold to a consumer in Bengal. But they never do prototyping. Ki yahan se wo sari bana ke wo aap bheje. And in Kolkata also, there will be different of taste. The older ladies may like the light colors. The younger ladies may like the dark colors. So whom they are targeting. Even the designing, I wish, should be from the happening from the people of the same culture where the end product is going. I say there is a fashion college in Kolkata, or a fashion designer who brought up and studied in Kolkata, a Bengali origin student. They can create the designs visualizing that prototyping better way. So prototyping mein aapka kya hoga? There are four color you sample in the market. Abhi, normally what we do in India, we produce all four color equal quantity, 1200, 1200, 1200. Now what happens, two colors sell, some color ka design jyada aata, demand is more, 1800 meters, some color is 2400 meter, and two color it is less than 1200. So what is happening, you are short and you are surplus, you are losing, you have 1200 meters of surplus stock and 1200 meters of lost stock. So prototyping and testing the concept on the market, sampling, big companies do, they have a proper catalog, catalog goes to the testing. But this is not done by smaller brands. India has got 25 crore, 50 crore small brands. They don't do prototyping. Automobile people do prototyping. Prototyping is a must for any design, whether it is jewelry design, whether it is a fashion design, textile design, furniture design. Prototyping gives you the idea what consumer is going to pay you. If your cost is higher, you can tweak it. If your design combos are wrong, or you know different design combos are going to sell in different proportion, then you will create, produce accordingly. So you will minimize value losses. So there are five steps, and this, there are a lot of videos on YouTube again on design thinking. So design creation is starting from the customer's empathy. What customer is looking for? What feature? What colors? Now colors may be different for different seasons, different occasions. So you are, where you are going to sell the product, what in the value engineering, what they say, what, why, when, where. So the four W's. So when you are going to sell it, why you want to sell it, whom do you want to sell it, and where do you want to sell it. Those four W's will teach you what design you are going to create, then go up to the fifth step and you will get the answer and go back to the drawing board for production. And match your timings are important. It's not that design thinking keeps on going on. You have to deliver the product on Dasara time, Kali Puja comes in Kolkata, then your material merchandise has to leave from the manufacturing center to the stores 1 month before Kolkata, Durga Puja. So if you miss Durga Puja, you lost 40% sales. So design thinking is not an activity in just an isolation, it's a time-bound activity. What, why, when, how, where, and it's a part of value engineering. So design thinking was started by Stanford Business School, but it is not rocket science. Again, there are a lot of videos on YouTube on Hindi, you can see that. So you have to think, design thinking is a process for solving any problem. It's not only for textile clothing. It can be any problem. They say you can solve the problem. There are n number of videos of practical application of design thinking. You can solve any problem by talking to the consumer. There are articles on mechanical, medical devices. There are articles on so many applications where products have been tweaked or products have been designed. Like if you see today in COVID, lot of innovations came because of design thinking. Like if you see that food operated your sanitizer, it was a process of design thinking, and people came with a problem that paise dabao. And yesterday I was seeing even the steam inhaler, which was designed from one outside pipe and common pipe, designed because of COVID. Lot of design thinking ideas came in various sectors. So we have to think out of the box. Design thinking is nothing rocket science. See, these words are actually coined by basically gurus. So we are very, you know, if this theory would have come out of India, nobody would have bothered about design thinking. It came from Stanford. So I had a course coming from Institut France, design thinking. Do you want to do a course? It was costing 1500 euro. So design thinking is a problem solving approach for any problem. And it starts with the consumer, and you go back to the consumer. What he told you the problem, you came up with the ideation, created the solution, created the prototype, created four or five options in the prototype also. One design may not work, but your chances of failure at the bulk level will go down. That is the power of design thinking. So design thinking se jo aaj hamare stores mein value loss hota hai, that value loss is 30-35%. That can be minimized by 15-20% easily by taking a design thinking approach. See, the retailer wants that shirt to be sold at 500 bucks and he wants 35% margin on that. Then your transportation milake, you should be able to deliver that X factory at 250 rupees. Then only the consumer is going to buy it. The retailer is going to make money. You are going to make money. So whole chain will make money. डिजाइनर विल बी पेड इफ द डिजाइन इज अ हिट. द डिजाइनर का नाम कब होगा? जब उसका डिजाइन हिट होगा. डिजाइनर इज लाइक अ डायरेक्टर ऑफ ए मूवी. द प्रोड्यूसर इज अ रिटेलर, इज अ फाइनेंसर. नो इफ द डिजाइनर्स मूवी बिकम्स हिट, ही इज हिट. बट डिजाइनर हैज टू थिंक, बट डिजाइन के पिक्चर का पैसा कौन देगा? तो ऑडियंस देगा. इफ ऑडियंस को मजा नहीं आया तो डिजाइनर इज नॉट, डायरेक्टर इज फ्लॉप. सो सेम थिंग हियर ऑल्सो. सो यू थिंक लाइक मूवी इंडस्ट्री, यू थिंक अक्रॉस इंडस्ट्रीज. टीवी पे, चैनल पे, इफ यू सी सीरियल, इफ सीरियल लाइकेबल, टीआरपी आएगा, ऑडियंस आएगी, एडवर्टाइजमेंट आएगी, सीरियल विल कंटिन्यू. सो यू हैव टू थिंक इन ए कॉमन सेंसिकल वे. एंड अगेन एवरीबडी हैज टू सिट टुगेदर. डिजाइनर्स को भी पैसा सीखना है. डिजाइनर्स डोंट अंडरस्टैंड मनी, इट डजंट वर्क. कपड़ा कितने का आता है, धागा कितने का है? आई ऑलवेज आस्क क्या भाव कपड़ा है. तो आई डोंट केयर, टेक केयर इन मीटर ऑल्सो. आई आस्क इन किलो, 250 रुपये किलो का कपड़ा है, इसमें कपास कितने का है? सो आई डोंट थिंक इन लीनियर मीटर्स, आई थिंक इन केजीज. आई नो हाउ मच मार्जिन द पीपल आर मेकिंग इन दैट फ्रॉम किलो अप्रोच. इफ यू गो टू सौराष्ट्र, पीपल टॉक वेट ऑफ द कार इन किलोज एंड दे टैक द कॉस्ट ऑफ किलो पर कार. दे डोंट से, दे से 600 किलो ની ગાડી છે, 3 લાખ રૂપિયા ભાવ છે, 500 રૂપિયા કિલોનો મટીરિયલ છે, આમાં એમાં નફો આટલો છે. દેટ ઇઝ વે પીપલ ટોક ઇન સૌરાષ્ટ્ર. સો યુ હેવ ટુ થિંક મટીરિયલ કોસ્ટ, યુ નો વોટ કન્ઝ્યુમર ઇઝ ગોઈંગ ટુ પે ફોર ઇટ. ઇફ યુ ગીવ ધ હોલ પ્રોડક્ટ એટ મે બી 5-10% ચીપર બાય ધીસ પ્રોસેસ, ધ મટીરિયલ ફ્લાય ઓફ ધ શેલ્ફ. ધ મેજર પ્રોબ્લેમ ઇન ઇન્ડિયા ઇઝ ટુડે રિટેલર્સ આર નોટ હેવિંગ ઇન્વેન્ટરી ટર્ન્સ. રકમ ઘૂમતી નહીં હૈ. The money, the inventory turns in India are 3 to 4. Now, if you see in India only, let's take, go to Hathikana. People sell steel, cement, all that. And they do 50 turns. Matlab, aaj maal aata hai, hafte bhar mein bik jata hai. They get the money back. So, 80 times, 50 times cement, steel, ghee, etc. They work on 3-4% margins. And they make 50 turns. So, design thinking is delighting the consumer at the features he is looking for, not give. If he wants red color and you give him yellow color, usko koi matlab nahi hai. Like if you go to Surat, Surat sells sadis across the country. Now they have masters specializing in each community color. They'll say Agrawal color means red and yellow. They'll say Punjab ka color means they know the dark colors. The people Tamil Nadu south different colors go. So the masters there specialize on each state. India has got 29 states. So masters know the color choice of each state also. So design thinking is about colors, the concept, the timeline when they want that product, what, why, when, how, where, and at what price they want to buy, which is for them bargain. Matlab agar aaj maine koi store mein item kharida, mere ko sasta laga, I'll definitely tell my 10 friends ki wahan jao maal kharido. So design thinking is that whole process, and it's a very simple 5-6 step process. Empathize with the customer, understand from him. Consumer is nothing but you, yourself. When you buy, what you think, what are your thought process? Customer is nothing, some animal coming from the alien world. We are consumers. We are 90% of the time consumers, 10% of the time non-consumers. So what you are when you buy, those thought process you have to put in the your left brain, right brain, and think like a consumer, empathize, problem solve, ideate. Ideate is multidisciplinary. I am telling you, a lot of times the ideas come from people outside your field. You may be a designer, I may be an engineer, but I have seen my workers giving me the best ideas. So you always talk to accountant. They will say, my HR manager, my accountant will tell something which I overlooked. And look at them. My peer also sometimes may give you a better idea. So a lot of ad campaigns, they are always shown to the peons. And peon ko puchte the maja aa raha hai. So if they say, nahi maja aa raha hai, so the campaign will be hit. So you have to talk to as many people as possible. This is all design thinking is all about. There are 5 steps. A lot of YouTube videos in Hindi, Marathi, English, you can see all many of them. Application of design thinking. But the best way to solve a lot of problems of our country. The problem is this kind of solutions, this kind of science, we are not applied in our day-to-day life. So we are doing it. Unknowingly we are doing design thinking. But we have to do it in a structured way. If you do it structured way, you can solve any problem. See, today we have a problem of say COVID vaccine delivery. How COVID vaccine will be delivered, how these are the science solutions which we can deliver, think on those ideas with mega scale also. Today we have a problem of oxygen. So today, yesterday IIT Delhi came out with Bombay came with a problem converting nitrogen plant into oxygen. So this is all design thinking according to me. So design thinking is not a rocket science, it's a thought process. Whatever I'm discussing today is all thought process. These are subjects which have been given coin names. We do it every day and we have to do it every day. As a designer, you will be able to do it and practice it very easily. If you practice that structure, you can learn the videos, memorize them, and once you watch 5-6 videos, you will get a hang of the subject. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a very knowledgeable session, sir. I hope all our participants will be able to understand it and use this knowledge while designing a user-friendly product by including all the 4 W's, that is the what, how, when, where. Without much wasting our time, we will begin with our Q&A session. So our first question is, how to create the balance between innovative design and functionality? Over to you, sir.
See, functionality is basically what is appealing to the consumer. The first question is, that is why the empathy is with the consumer. What you are creating may be innovative for you, but is it innovative for the consumer? That is the first question. Apna bachcha sabko pyara lagta hai. So you may be liking your design too much, but does the consumer like it? That is the first fundamental question. So functional design is nothing, also part of functionality only. Agar aapne achhi design nahi bana, main aapka kapda bana hua khareedunga nahi. So functionality is a part of, design is a part of functionality, I would say. So consumer, that's the first step, no? Empathize, problem solve. Wo bolega achha design yahan milta nahi hai. So what design is looking for? Talk. Then you will come out, because sometimes consumer himself doesn't know what he wants. See, Steve Jobs was successful in Apple because he created design which even consumer was not aware of. See, sometimes consumer cannot tell you ki mujhe aisa chahiye, he cannot describe it. Sometimes people have unhidden demands. They don't know. But it is your idea to decode the black box of the consumer. If you can decode that black box, what he even delighting is something which even he didn't think of in his dreams, then you are the game. Then you are influencing the consumer. You are driving his thought process. The functionality in innovation is delighting the consumer. So talk to consumers. Sometimes you could come out ahead of them thinking also. The consumer is not always right. Consumer has a lot of clarity or confusion. Consumer is confused sometimes. So you have to come with ideas which give more clarity. Even in shop, if you see, the shopkeeper helps the consumer buy. Yeah, ye dekho na, iske saath achha lagega. So sometimes salesmen are smart. Even if you go to restaurant, the smart waiters, they recommend the menu for you. Aap bologe kya kya khana hai. So you are not clear what you want. You the guy who's there, he influences your thought process. He reads you properly. It's your job to read the consumer and tell him what he wants. Sometimes. Does that answer? I hope it answers you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. This is second question is, how to stay consistent with the quality and creativity of design?
Pardon?
Okay, sir, I'm repeating once more. So how to stay consistent with quality and creativity of design? Like how to balance quality and creativity of design, sir?
There is not confused about quality of design. I am only understand creativity of design. There is nothing like quality of design. Quality is aesthetics. Creativity is, design is nothing but creativity and aesthetics. Quality hoti nahi design mein. It's what your consumer likes, that's quality. So according to me, the quality word is not gelling with designs. It's only creativity and aesthetics which comes with design. Quality is a different product. It's a performance features and all that, durability and blah blah blah. Creativity and aesthetics aap samajh sakte ho, that design what consumer ko appeal karti hai, that design. Jo in a nutshell I would say, what is design? It's ultimately in Hindi one, there is word dulan wahi jo piya man bhaye. So what product you create, it is appealing to the consumer, that is quality, that is aesthetics, that is creativity. You created a product which doesn't appeal to the consumer, and consumer has a different culture, different taste. Each consumer has a different background, education background, academic background, finance level. So you have to decode who is your consumer first. See, you can't sell every product to every consumer. First, define who is your consumer. What is the price point you want to sell? It's A segment, B segment, C segment, D segment. Who is your customer? Imagine a dummy customer. And then you create a product for that customer at the price which is affordable to him and likable to him, make him feel good about your product. So you have defined your consumer is very important.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is another question that why people are ready to buy Apple gadgets in spite of higher price, but they don't go for luxury clothing. Both are appealing and needing. Why electronic gadgets stand out from fashion?
Pardon?
Sir, there's a question from Deepak. So why people are ready to buy Apple gadgets because of their higher price, but they don't go for luxury clothing. Both are appealing also and needy, but why electronic gadgets stand out from fashion?
I won't say like that ki only electronic gadgets are selling or fashion is not selling. It's a basically a question of how do you, what product makes the customer his esteem go up. See, when you have an Apple in your pocket or something, it helps your self-esteem. You have an Apple gadget, even if people flaunt, they have an Apple phone, Apple laptop, blah, blah, blah. But I'll tell you, some designers, like say, there was a designer called Ed Hardy. In Christian Odiger, his brand was Ed Hardy. Now, there's a brand called Versace. If you go to Bangalore, there is a mall of UB in which a t-shirt sells at 20,000 rupees and there is a discounted price is 18,000 rupees. And there are brands like Versace or Gucci or even Armani. Those brands, they are aspirational or dream of a consumer. Now, if you create a product of that quality or that perception, and there are three things for that. It's not only the product. It's a brand, it's a perception, it's a presentation and positioning. How do you position? Because it's a complex subject. The consumer, when they buy, going to the stores, visual merchandising plays a role, the ambience plays a role, the branding plays a role, the shop floor salesman who sells plays a role, all luxury goods. When they are sold in a particular way. So selling is again a very important part of the subject. If you go to Apple store, there is a distinct way of selling Apple products. So if you want to sell luxury products, you have to sell in a right way. You can't sell luxury product just because a luxury product people don't buy it. There is something wrong in which we have not created the right impression in the minds of the consumer. Why he buys Apple and why he doesn't buy your product? It is not nothing to do with consumer not willing to buy your product. It's not the way you have presented it, the way he wants to be presented. See, there are a lot of high fashion stores, streets in India. If you go to Bombay, there are high fashion streets where all the luxury brands are sitting there. So if you go to Chennai, Bangalore, Hyderabad, all top 10 cities, there are particular roads on which all luxury brands are sitting. So it's your positioning of that product, even online. Now today, if you see Tata Click, they are only selling premium products. They are a different website than a routine website. So it's not that people don't want to buy luxury brands. It's how you position them, how to present them, how you are connecting with the audience who is going to buy your product. Suppose your brand is a premium brand, which magazines you are advertising or which how you create a hype around your brand on Facebook or social media or anything. So those are the ideas which you need to look at. So marketing is a separate science. You're just creating a luxury brand doesn't help. You have to go for strategy of marketing also.
And another question, sir. Why India more focus on sustainability?
Pardon?
Why India focus on more sustainability concept?
Yeah, because see, as a country, we have been sustainable for ages. Our society was always sustainable. We got into consumerism in last 50 years. And we are seeing the disastrous problems of that in consumerism. So we were as sustainable society for 5,000 years. It's not that today we are doing sustainability is something which gurus are teaching us. We have been sustainable. We have just lost that our whole original thought process in all the life by getting Western influence of last 150 years. We have to go back to our basics. Sustainability was our natural culture. Everything what we are doing, reusing clothes, reusing everything in our house to the last point was our part, is a part of our culture. We don't have to lose it. We have to just go back to it. We just lost in last 30, 40 years. We have to go back there and we will go there because today there will be no water. Today we are seeing so many problems of this excessive consumption. We will have to go back. That's why I said people are, even H&M is saying purana kapda use karo. which in India was anyway being done in last generation. And people are reusing clothes and reusing everything. So we'll go there. The time demands it, and we'll go there. We have to find business models to support that. So we can go there, and we will be going there.
Thank you, sir. Just the last question. What are the qualities required to be a successful designer?
See, as a designer, first of all, you have to think what market you want to cater to. What are you good at? What are the segments? Like if you are looking at menswear, womenswear, home furnishing, what designs you, what segment you want to cater to? Then whether you are good at creating value for money product or you are good at multiple disciplines, that's your thought process. What products you can create, which market you can create, and ultimately what is the commercial success you can create out of your creativity for the end chain. You are paid only a fraction of what you create for the whole system. Suppose you created a design which sold 10,000 pieces and 10,000 pieces amount to say profit of say 2-3 lakh rupees across the chain. Then you will be paid some 2,000-5,000 rupees as a designer, 10,000 rupees as a designer for that product. And if you can create such products repeatedly, again creativity ka fatigue aa jata hai. A picture bhi, if you make 5 hit movies, 6 movies a flop. So creativity ka dhanda bhi fatigue wala dhanda hai. So if you are not, you can create the level of creativity continuously, then you have to think which segment I should target and where I will not be fatigued. Creative fatigue is, maintaining creativity is difficult. So where you will not be fatigued and creativity ka paisa milta rahega. So you have to be entrepreneur also, think entrepreneurially. Where you can create money, your salary, your money is a byproduct of what value you created for the system. If you created 100 rupees value into the system, you will be definitely paid 5-10 rupees. That's my this thing. As a designer, you have to think that where you are going to add value, they will be paid for that. Nobody is going to pay you just because you are a designer and your design doesn't sell.
Thank you, sir. Due to the limitation of time, we can't take all the questions. Now we will move toward the our third topic, that is the additional base costing. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. See, activity-based costing is one subject which is not being practiced in India, because this is a book on activity-based costing. It is published by ICWA, and activity-based costing is very important to fashion industry, because in fashion industry every day the article changes. It's not like, you know, producing cement or steel where you have a single raw material and you continuously produce one steel. So your raw material is same and your finished product also. Raw material may be changing slightly, ore may change, coal may change, but your finished product is maybe steel and you keep on producing steel or cement, something like that, 3, 4, 5 grades. And there is no fashion, much change in a fashion of steel or cement. But textile may care, everything from the fiber, the way you want knits, wovens, synthetic, cotton, blend, this, that, to up to end product, to again cutting, tailoring, garmenting, all that changes. Everything is changing. So you people tend to do a mistake. They do average costing. Average costing means every article you take average cost ki 40 taka kapde ka le lo, 20 taka tailoring ka le lo, 20 taka iska le lo, 20 taka profit le lo. It doesn't work that way. So activity based costing gives you a precise cost component for each product separately. You can't say meri factory, mere shop ka overhead hai 5 lakh rupees. So I have sold say merchandise of 30 lakhs, so my average overhead is say 15%. It doesn't work that way. In the stores, you have say 200 articles. Now you have to create a value for selling and effort required to sell each article separately. And then you apportion the overheads on each product separately. It could be marketing overheads, it could be manufacturing overheads. So all the products have, and then even the manufacturing time overhead, the finance cost. In textile, right from cotton, what I say cotton to cash. Cotton aata hai, you go to ginning, ginning to spinning, spinning to weaving, weaving to processing, then garmenting, then retailing. It is a cycle of 12 months. So cotton to cash, there is so many activities. There is so much of finance cost, so much of hidden cost, so much of wastage. Now activity-based costing teaches you where all unrelated costs are happening and how to minimize them. Because ultimately your value for money equation comes from reducing your time of manufacturing, reducing your process losses, reducing your major cost. Suppose fabric is your major cost, 40%. Can you reduce the cost of 40% fabric? Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah.
Yes.
So activity-based costing is a science which tells you to apportion the cost depending on the activity, right from the raw material to manufacturing to retailing of that particular product. Now, just to tell you an example, I did a seminar on activity-based costing some 15 years back. They told me that if your margin is less than 7-8%, less than 10%, and if you follow principles of activity-based costing, where you do product by product analysis, then you can improve your margins by 4-5%. That is a huge jump. You know, if you are doing 8% profit and 5% goes up, means 50% jump because of activity-based costing. Now, activity-based costing tells you which products you are losing money, which products we are using. You are making money. Sometimes activity-based costing also tells you ki kya andar karna chahiye, kya bahar karna chahiye. Suppose if you have an in-house design team and you are paying X amount of salaries and the number of designs you are getting is 100 designs and your design team costing salary of say 2 lakh rupees per month, and then you know that this is my design cost per article. Now, if I get those designs from outside, I am going to save money. So activity costing tells you that, what to manufacture in-house, what to outsource. So in textile industry, if you see the bulk of the global retailers today, they don't have any manufacturing factory themselves. They just do designing, creation, they outsource manufacturing, they buy the finished product, sell it into the stores. So they learnt it the harder way. Earlier they had the factories. Today Levi's had a factory of denim in USA 100 years back. Today Levi's doesn't produce any jeans. It's people who produce for them. So activity-based costing tells you what is a smart way, what does it cost you, whether it is efficient way of doing those things in-house, outside, and documenting the activities for each product, each service, and see what needs to be done efficiently, where you are losing money, where you are wasting money. So activity-based costing is a science which you need to learn in deep, because it is, you can't practice activity-based costing or learn it. There is a 4-year subject on activity-based costing taught to ICWS. Unfortunately, in India, we have CS. We don't use ICWA. ICWA are the people who give you the perspective of what cost you are doing on each activity, where you are losing money, where you are making money. Just to give an example, if you go to the hotel and you order a room tea in the room and the tea costs 50 bucks, but the waiter comes to your room, gives you, takes the order, then gives you the tea, picks up the cup back again, it costs to the hotel is 200 bucks. So people, hotel stop selling tea and they put a tea kit in your room because they are losing 150 rupees by doing that service to you. So similarly, in activity-based costing, what, suppose as I told you last example, the fabric. Now, if you are buying a fabric of narrow width, 45 inches, and you buy a fabric of 85 inches, you tell premium, you save 10-15%. You say, okay, I'll give 4% extra cost over the width parameter. So my width is double, I'll pay you double plus 5%. So you save 10%, the consumer, the manufacturer gets 5%. So he or he gets more efficiency. So activity-based costing tells you what width to buy, what designs to create, even the repeats. And suppose, as I tell you, Siri, some example is smaller runs. Today in the fashion, fast fashion world, creating smaller runs is less risky. So activity-based costing tells you how to create smaller runs with profit, and you'll make more money there. So activity-based costing defines the, there are 4-5 steps in activity-based costing, and those steps you have to learn. Process, activity, there is a work order, there are so many 5-6 steps are there. You can learn those on the net or in the books, But activity-based costing can change your perspective about each thing. Now I'll tell you just simple example. There are some products you lose money and you don't do post analysis. You take an order, you execute the order, you lose money. But at the end of the day, in textile industry, you do say 1,000 products in a year. Now we have to do postmortem. I assume 15% profit beginning of the order. I assume that I'll produce in so much cost. This usually never happens. We are always off the mark. And I sold at a Y price. I assume my price will be 80. I sold at 100 rupees. Actually, my price was sometimes 105 rupees. I made a loss of 5%. Now, just a classical example. In textile industry, people say, अभी एक छोटा रन बना दो, बाद में मैं आपको बड़ा ऑर्डर दूंगा, उसमें आप कमा लेना. दैट बिगर ऑर्डर नेवर कम्स. सो दैट सैम्पलिंग ऑर्डर इज अ लॉस मेकिंग बिजनेस फॉर मोस्ट ऑफ द पीपल. द पीपल डोंट हैव द गट्स टू से कि नहीं, इसका भाव इस छोटे ऑर्डर का, जैसे इफ यू गो टू बनाना तो डजन का भाव पूछे, अगर आप एक किला मांगो तो आपको गाली देगा. सिमिलर यार जैसे ओके, आपको अगर ये छोटा सैम्पल मेरे से करवाना है, इसका प्रोटोटाइप सर्विसिंग का भाव अलग है, बल्क ऑर्डर का अलग भाव है. So you don't lose money. So what businesses or jobs you lost money, they are the dogs. And where you made money, they are the stars. So you pursue minimizing, avoiding the dogs. Itself doubles your profit. See, just an example, like I made 20% profit in 50% jobs. And I paid 10% loss in 50% job. So my net profit was 10%. Now what do I do next year? I avoid these 10% fellows. And I just stick to my 20% fellows. So what will happen? My profit will double. So activity-based costing will teach you postmortem by postmortem what not to do and what to do more. Which of your customers pay you on time? Which of your customers delay? The money, sometimes you get 15% margin on paper, but the consumer pays you after 4 months. What is the net cost? You made only 5%. 10% you lost. So sometimes another customer pays you maybe 7% margin, but he pays you cash. So you better stick to this 7% guy because he's making you more money than the guy who pays 15% after 4 months. Your cash flow is better. So activity-based costing helps you analyze the net realization, the bad debt risk, the manufacturing cost, all the things you have to take into consideration. So what fabric to buy, how much to cut the cost in the value losses, how to create designs. Now, in design, what GSM fabric you are taking, sometimes in the summer months, you don't have require a heavy GSM fabric. So you can cut the cost. In winters, you require maybe heavy GSM fabric because the winters, the climate is cold. So you are also, you have to realize which climate you are selling the product. So you can cut down the cost. I'll just give an example. This is a fabric which I am selling for Khanga Kitanga. Here, this fabric doesn't require two-side penetration. Now, with the help of activity-based costing, I can get the weight through printing and I can make it cheaper because it's going to a dark climate, dark country, dark consumer color is dark, where they want dark colors. Now, with the help of this theory, I can cut down the cost by creating a design which suits the complexion of the consumer. Rather than they using dark color, I change the color of the design to lighter colors, make them look smart. So costing, this process is very polluting, two-side penetration. Now if I say one-side penetrating, there will be less pollution. The cost will be less. So these are the things which you learn from activity-based costing. What are the processes, allied process? There are 4 or 5 steps. And those steps you can master gradually. So you have to take the help of cost accountants. Cost accountant will tell you which product you are losing money, why you are losing money, where you have to minimize the loss, and that is itself your profit. First, though, minimize losses, that's your profit. Then go for value addition, which customer pay you more, work on those. Now, design, I'll just tell you example design. Now, design doesn't add value from the manufacturing process. I can tell you, if you designers think, you can cut the cost of the product by 10 to 15%. Your design value addition is separate. You are cutting cost on the manufacturing side with activity-based costing, itself can be 10-15%. So you are making money for the chain two ways. One from the input side, second from the output side. So think in both the sides. So this is how activity-based costing will help you. So you have to master this science, take the help of ICWS, and they will do the analysis for you. Because costing is a subject There is an online course on ICWA on basics of costing. This everybody has to learn. See, in our life, we deal with money. Whether it's my salary, I have to deal with money. I have to deal with arts, I have to deal with commerce, I have to deal with science. So activity-based costing, everybody has to understand, learn. There are 4-5 steps. There is a difference between traditional costing and activity-based costing. Traditional costing goes on averages. And activity-based costing focuses on each product, its manufacturing process, its selling process. See, sometimes selling cost is very important. Sometimes you have to do a lot of promos, you have to do a lot of sampling. So that is a cost. And the how long it takes to sell that article. The money is, finance cost is completely continuously ticking. So till the consumer swipes the card, that is the cotton to cash. So you have to take into account everything. The finance cost of selling, the store shelf disposal cost, the manufacturing cost. Sometimes the retail cost is 3 times the manufacturing cost. So how do you cut down the retail cost? That's why the online came today. So you have to think, what consumer is going to pay me for, what consumer is not going to pay me for, how can I cut down the flab, where and where. And say today, handloom people, handloom articles, they are uniquely produced. Now there are a lot of middlemen in between that kalakar, the karigar, and the designer and the consumer. Now because of the internet, that is getting disrupted. You can sell that product across the world today. So you can create this whole model in a disruptive way. That retailing cost I can cut down. How can I reach the consumer? I can take the measurement of the consumer. Even today, say today, tomorrow, Amazon is thinking, they will take the measurements of the consumer with a body scanner, stitch the garment, show them the design, and deliver in 48 hours. So there will be no wastage of fabric, there will be no wastage of garments. So all these things you have to take into thinking, holistic thinking. Kapas is spinning, engineering, processing, retailing, marketing, brand building, everything is a cost. And activity-based costing tells you how to create a brand at an economical rate, how to retail in a right way. The bulk of the cost, a lot of times people say, hamara 500 rupees ka product hai, MRP pe 2,500 rupees lag jata hai. Ya 500 rupees ka product hai, 5,000 ho jata hai MRP. Why? Can't we sell at 500 rupees ka product in 1,000 bucks? That is all activity-based costing tells you. Ki where the retailer just is a shopkeeper. Why is charging so much to take your product to a consumer at a 5x price, 10x price? I have seen a lot of retailers, they used to say we ship decimal to the right. Means $4.8 they used to pay our Indian vendor, and the MRP on the tag was $48. The decimal was shifted to the right. So much of inefficiency. Today that has gone. Today the article which is going from India at $4 is actually selling at $6, $7 in the stores abroad. Same thing in India also. So a lot of flab has come out of this retail chain. So same thing, you have to think on these ways in different ways. It's a manufacturing waste, it's a retailing waste, it's a sourcing waste, cutting waste, marking efficiency. All those things you have to think of. Weight, how much weight consumer wants, how much fastness standard consumer wants. Customer ko kya chahiye? They like good designs. Yeah, you have to create good prints, you have to create good motifs. Jo aapko dena hai, wo dijiye. But jo nahi dena hai, wo kaati hai. And usme you will create more value. So it's a two-way subject. Jo nahi hai, usko chop karna hai. Jo chahiye, usko dena hai. But that you have to analyze through all these. First subject was value engineering, then design thinking, and then activity-based costing. What you did there in the first two steps, now you have to think of the cost, what you do. And think critically. Retail is a paisa game. So every paisa matters in the retail industry. Because articles are in millions, so people say every cent matters. So you have to, Walmart is a state answer to this. Walmart buys the cheapest and they sell the value for money to the consumer. IKEA. These are the people who do activity-based costing day in, day out. And that's why they are successful. So retail is an industry, very tough competitive industry. But if you think logically, you can cut down a lot of flab, give better value to the consumer, and you will grow. Otherwise, that if you see in India, our Indian retailers are not doing well. But H&M, C&A, today Pantaloon Big Bazaar is sold. But H&M, C&A, H&M, Zara, everybody is doing well in India. And people are buying. M&S is buying. And we are not doing well. Vero Moda is selling. All foreign retailers are doing well. Why we are not doing something wrong? So maybe your brand perception is not right, or positioning is not right, or merchandise is not right. All that you have to cut out the waste and invest money in those areas where you are weak. So activities costing tells you where to cut flap and where to invest. We do sometimes wrong value engineering in the wrong areas. जहाँ पैसा बचाना नहीं है वहाँ पैसा बचाते हैं, और जहाँ पैसा खर्चना है वहाँ नहीं करते. We don't spend money on designing. We don't spend money on creativity in terms of positioning. Good marketing, smart people. So all those things we need to think. Just an example like Fab India. Fab India is like a handloom brand. And today they are very successful because position themselves. They are actually a Gora counterpart of Khadi Gramodyog. So they have positioned themselves well and they make good money out of it. So all these things you have to think in a holistic way. So costing, that's why I told you, handloom is one area where a lot of inefficiency exists. If you make handlooms affordable and fashionable, I can tell you it's a gold mine. It's a gold mine. Indian handlooms, technology, manufacturing, there's a lot of inefficiency. If you can fix it right, they are handmade products, they can go across the world. So think those ways where you are unique in India. We have 500,000 power looms, handlooms. We can think of how to increase the efficiency of the handlooms, make them more affordable, sustainable, because handlooms is bahut mahanga. That's the problem. If you make handloom affordable, fashionable, handloom will fly. Because handloom is very eco-friendly, very comfortable to user and all that. So activity-based costing tells you to avoid the unwanted cost, where you are losing money, which product you are losing money, which service you are losing money. It's not in a store. There are SKUs, 70,000 SKUs there in every store. You have to think each SKU is a profit center. Each SKU, stock keeping unit. Is that SKU making money for you? That SKU lost money? Why you lost money? That is where the retailers think. So whether your shirt was making money and cap is not making money, then you have to fix the cap problem. Don't put the loss of the cap on the shirt. So this is what activity-based costing tells you. I hope this is the this question. I can take the question now.
Thank you so much, sir. The cost is a very prime factor, especially in this COVID pandemic. This activity-based costing tells us where we are losing money and making money. With the examples given like cotton to cash, garmenting, retailing, examples of smaller runs and hand loom also. So now there is a time for a question and answer session. The first question is, how to do a profitable business in the COVID pandemic?
Yeah, in COVID pandemic, you know, the logistics are going to be affected. The consumer are not going to walk. I saw a very interesting example. Selling through video calls. See, we went to a shop, Sejal Handicrafts in Baroda. We asked them, how do you sell? He said, I explain the article through video calls to the consumer. Consumer is seeing the video call, then I'm selling. So use technology like augmented reality, virtual reality. Those are the new technology which are going to come. Embrace them. Embrace them. Because you can't be, see, all this today what we discussed are not a part of our routine knowledge. This knowledge is applied to everybody. So you have to understand what machine learning will do for me, what data management will do for me, what artificial intelligence will do for me. Embrace all the technologies and use them where you can avoid physical contact with the consumer. Show him value. Explain him, sitting in your store or in your house, you can create a store, whatever merchandise. Now these technologies can help you to connect with any consumer. You can have video chat. Explain the product to him, create some trust. Sometimes people can't see. If you go to a passive website of Amazon, you will not be able to sell. But if you create your personal store with a video call with the customer, this Sejal Handicraft is doing successfully. He is not able to, he has a proper COVID protocol and is selling with videos. You can do it. Your consumer may be anywhere. And to the communication technology allow you to connect with your consumer. You can use Facebook, you can use Google and all that digital marketing. And digital marketing to zaruri hai dhanda karne ke liye. So videos and digital marketing AR VR should be adopted.
Thank you, sir. The second question is from Sadai. Which is more important, functionality or aesthetic?
Boss, functionality and aesthetics are a two side of the coin. If I want a shirt, it has to fit me well and it has to look well. So I cannot say ki mera शर्ट फिट बराबर हो रहा है लेकिन दिखने में अच्छा नहीं है. सो इट इज अ टू साइड ऑफ द कॉइन. दे गो हैंड इन हैंड. यू कांट से फंक्शनलिटी एंड एस्थेटिक्स आर दोनों में अलग क्या क्या इंपॉर्टेंट. बोथ आर इंपॉर्टेंट. इट लाइक यूर कॉइन हेड एंड टेल. ए कॉइन हैज वन साइड दिस एंड वन साइड दैट. विदाउट दैट कॉइन विल नेवर बी ए फ्लैट ऑन वन साइड. नो. सो यू हैव टू फंक्शनलिटी एंड एस्थेटिक गो हैंड इन हैंड.
Thank you, sir. The third question is from Tanushree Chopra. If we are to make a handloom affordable, how are we going to adjust the labor cost with this?
Yeah, I'll tell you.
How the workers are already being exploited a lot in fashion industry.
No. I am not saying that exploiting the labor. No. I am not saying. Some people misunderstood me. See, I'll tell you a very simple example. In handlooms, the efficiency of the process is very, very low. You don't reduce the income of the worker. I am telling you some of the efficiency of the loom, hand loom. If you are running at a speed of say 20 picks per minute, then your process production for a day should be some 10, 20, 30 meters. On a hand loom, people are producing 1 meter or 2 meter. Now, improve the efficiency of the loom. So the weaver gets more money. I am not saying weaver ka paisa kaato. I am telling that the efficiency of the machines, the looms needs to improve. Today we have a solar charka designed by Lakshmi Mills in South. So you print high value stuff on the table, small runs. So handlooms, guys will make money. Pigment dyeing aap kar sakte ho. Even say like in our Uttaran, we have a manja. We apply manja on the yarn. There is a color there. So can you design a machine which gives you manja or efficiency on the loom? And I can promise you the efficiency of the loom is very low. If you improve the handloom of the efficiency by 10-20 times, it is possible. Our normal machine looms have 90% efficiency. We have a textile engineering professor here. They are sitting there. Can they improve the efficiency of the loom of handloom? It can go to 20-30%. Definitely it can go. Then the income of the weaver will be more. Your fabric damage will be less. And your cost will go down. See, we don't have to think only labor cost. It's the fixed cost. The labor output is in the problem. People have innovated so many things on the machines and dyeing and printing in the mechanical world. We have not developed simple machines for dyeing, printing or table printing. You can do high quality print. If you see videos on YouTube, bulk of the high quality printing happens on tables. But we have a very bad quality tables in India. We can have a nice glass tables like abroad. And print quality stuff. Even we people fix the fabric on the table with the outdated method of gum and pins. People have two-side tape and you can fix the fabric and on the table. Print nicely. As I gave you example of pigment dyeing. People are not even silk. Silk is very expensive. Aap usme pigment dyeing karo. Usse vajan badhega. I am dyeing pigment dyeing on silk. Fab India ne mereko kapda bheja tha. There is a problem of reducing the avoiding the shine. They are solving the problem. So you can do n number of things in handlooms also with innovative approach. Problem is people are all textile engineers only think of machine looms. No textile engineering college has thought about improving the efficiency of the process of handlooms. There is a huge opportunity to upgrade them efficiently. Industrial engineering. So cost kam ho jayegi. Cost kam ho jayegi, the labor ka bhi income badhega. And Fab India wahi kar raha hai. Fab India is doing same thing. They are not exploiting. They are a social enterprise. Achha, so they make money, their suppliers make money. It's a win-win for all. We can do it.
Thank you, sir, for your elaborative answers with your hands-on experience, day-to-day real-life examples. Thank you, sir. Over to you, Kriti, ma'am.
Thank you, Sumi. Now I would like to invite our webinar convener, Dr. Reena Bhatia, Assistant Professor, Department of Clothing and Textiles, Faculty of Family and Community Sciences, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, to end up the session with a vote of thanks. Over to you, madam.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. I'm sure this webinar has been value for time. I know I cannot use the word money because there was no money involved here. So, and it has equally appealed and enriched the knowledge of our young students, researchers, academicians, entrepreneurs, and administrators. It is certain and clear that you will surely share the learned concepts with many more and also connect with still many more others from different disciplines to serve your own and the consumer's interests, bringing in value for money invested. At the onset, I extend my humble thanks to the patron of the webinar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sir Professor Parimal Vyas, for his constant encouragement and support for the activities like these that provide students with experiences to shape their life skills along with their careers. I express a sincere and heartfelt gratitude to Mr. Ashok Sarda, the well-informed and experienced speaker, for taking out time from his busy schedule and enlightening us with his rich and tremendous knowledge, unraveling the mysteries in the field of textile manufacturing and design, of course, with the consumer at the core of the process. It undoubtedly gave us deep insights with simple, common day-to-day examples about value engineering, design thinking process, and activity-based cost analysis. I would surely want to share this concern of Mr. Sharda for enhancing students' knowledge of the new concepts in the industry, which gave direction to hold the theme, to have the theme of this webinar. We humbly appreciate his involvement in not just patiently resolving all the questions raised, but also in sharing relevant resources with the participants before the webinar, so that they come prepared in that manner. Thank you so much, sir. We earnestly thank our special guest, Professor Anjali Karolia. I know ma'am could not make it because of...
Reena, I'm here.
Oh, thank you so much, ma'am. Then I think we should listen from you. We need to have some special remarks.
My apologies for not being there. I really wanted to attend this particular webinar. Mr. Sharda, I was really looking forward to this, and I extend my apologies for not being here in the beginning and hearing you through the whole session. But because of all these problems with the universities and education, we've all had to start looking at various ways of administration and what is to be done with all our students who are here and the examinations and so on. But I did hear the last bit of your, I think you were answering somebody's question, and something that struck a note with me when you said that the technology behind the handloom is something that is being neglected, and improving the handloom should also be, looked at. And I have Satyajit here with me. And in fact, we are always getting into this argument for the last 30 years, I think, with his department, when they would always tell us in our department that you people are only into handlooms and khadi and looking into, and this is not the pal, palloom is what they look at, and mass production. And so I always would tell them, I said, that's your area of specialization and what you need to look at. And this is our area of but I think it's time that we, try and put these two, not really have these differences between, whether it is Palum or whether it is, and I think they should both have their own areas of production. And what we can achieve in a handloom and what you can achieve in a Palum are totally different. Where I don't agree is when the Palum tries to take over the designs of the handloom. That is where I have a little problem. But I think I really wish I could have heard it, but thank you so much. And I'm sure the whole university and people from outside also have really, appreciated whatever you have shared with them. And definitely is going to be useful to all the staff as well as the faculty, as well as all our students. I think the students will really benefit from this. And of course, faculty also in their teaching, in their research, and so on. So thank you for being here. And I once again apologize for not being there in the beginning of the session. So, and congratulations to Reena, Madhu, Satyajit, and Jairam. I see him also here for hosting this particular webinar. So, congratulations to all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anjali ma'am. I would also like to thank Anjali ma'am on my personal behalf for her prompt response, guidance, and support offered every time and anytime at each stage of organizing this webinar. Thank you so much, ma'am. I humbly acknowledge the consensus of our webinar directors, Professor Madhusharan, Dr. Satyajit Chaudhary, and Dr. Jairam Podwal, to come together to organize this multidisciplinary webinar, making this endeavor more meaningful. Hope this consent brings in greater good for our students who need to be prepared for further future, which requires multidisciplinary approach for problem solving. We already have come together from allied disciplines, and there is further need to bring people from finance, fashion communication, marketing, psychology, business economics, and many, many others to come together to bring value for money for a product to not just the manufacturer, but also the consumers. Yeah, that's the core. They are at the core. So words would fall short to express my heartfelt appreciations for our webinar coordinators, their enterprising support, silent and careful execution of all the tasks before time, and cooperation amongst each other and coordination, which has contributed immensely for smooth operations of this webinar. Keep it up, dear Kanika Chaudhary, Kriti Sharma, and Sumi Alghar. Special thanks are due to Mr. Prateek Patel and Mr. Achal Parekh for their coordinated technical efforts to bring this event to you on Zoom and Facebook Live. A very warm thank you to the team of our university's communication cell for promoting our event and streaming our webinar live on the university's official Facebook page. Last but not the least, it is the dear participants, your overwhelming response and engagement, both in Zoom room and the Facebook Live, have made this webinar a success. We promise to bring you more such new and engaging concepts to ensure your presence and learning every time. Surely, no event is complete by the grace of the Almighty. Amidst these difficult times as a pandemic, we have had this opportunity to learn, and many more people who have been associated with this event indirectly have been instrumental to make this happen. So gratitude and appreciations for each one of them. Thank you to one and all. Thank you so much. Over to you, Kriti.
Thank you, madam. So now heading towards the end of the webinar, may I now request everyone to rise for the national anthem.
अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता अब सिंधु
मनमाना Jaya, 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 Jaya.
I once again thank each one of you to be with us. Hope to see you all again in upcoming webinars. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Prati, are you there? Prati, hello.
Hi, ma'am.
There's a feedback form. I think we'll be sharing the link.
Yeah. Thank you, yes, everyone. Ma'am.
Pratik, you can stop Thank the Facebook Live.
Okay.
We're going to have many.